So, hey y'all, this is April.
And this is Caroline.
And this is your bloody happy hour.
Is this 100?
This is 100.
And we're not celebrating?
We are.
We should have had a celebration drink or something.
Cheers!
Oh, look at that.
I have a little bit of Tito's in my cup.
I'm drinking a ranch water.
Is it the one left over from last week?
I think so. I think I have the same can.
Same can and everything.
Saving money, trying to recycle.
I hate that, right. You've had such a stressful 2 weeks leading up to our 100th episode. It should have been a party.
I've not been alive. I've been mourning. And I've been not motivated to do pretty much anything.
She's been on Do Not Disturb, but I'm giving her 2 weeks off from researching, basically.
You know, I usually feel that's like my outlet. Like if I'm like, oh, I'm stressed out, let me go look at murder or watch some murder, like do my research. No, I never want to do anything.
Yeah. Yep. Maybe just brain break.
I think it might be a brain break.
Take a brain break. And then I'm going to expect you to give me one here after this shit.
I can give you one in
2 weeks.
Yes, but also I'm doing a good dog sitting gig in a couple of weeks.
So you're going to be researching?
So I'm going to have a whole week at a house with a pool. Okay. We can
talk
about that later, but
the 100th episode, y'all.
Oh.
I know we told you. It's not a surprise. We're keeping it in Waco. We've been talking about it since January. I was supposed to have been researching since January. But you know me. I started researching 3 days ago.
Yeah.
So here it is. We're going to talk about the Waco massacre.
Oh.
And it's literally a massacre.
Oh.
And Caroline, we've lived in Waco just about our whole life.
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
And
yep.
I've never done a deep dive into David Koresh.
I haven't either.
The first time I watched a documentary was just the other day when it came out for the 30th
anniversary.
Yeah. And you still haven't watched that, right?
No, I have not.
So I love it because you're hearing things for the first time.
I am.
And for those of you out there that have heard stuff, listen, there's so much information out there. I can't cover it all. I'm not going to cover it all. It's pissing me off researching it because there is so much.
And there's so many sides. And there's so much. And then it gets political.
There's so much sides. And then it gets political. And then it goes into conspiracies. So I'm doing the best I can. Have fun. We're just going to go. We're going to do it. So my sources.
We're going to break them down into like, a shorter,
yeah,
yeah. We're not going to compile you with the whole 2-hour story.
No.
We don't want you to fall asleep.
It's too big,
and you have attention span like me, which is not very.
Yes, long. So you're going to get shorter parts. So today you're going to get 4 parts. You do not have to listen to all 4 because we're going to break up the parts. You got to click on the part 2 to get part 2.
Mm-hmm.
All right, you're going to click on part 3 to get part 3. So you listen to them all at the same time, or you can break them up if you want to. But then guess what? Next week, you're going to get the ending and then some of the conclusions and like the final chapters and everything.
And the conspiracies.
And the conspiracies, which is all Caroline cares about.
Basically.
So one of my sources was a report from the Department of Treasury. It's the report of Vernon Wayne Howe, which is who we know as David Koresh. That was his real name. And then a book called Ranch Apocalypse by Dan Morris. And so I'm going to start off with a quote from the author, Dan Morris. February 28th, 1993 was about to become another date in American history that would live in infamy. This violent confrontation would also result in the longest shootout in law enforcement history, the longest siege in law enforcement history, and the worst tragedy in law enforcement history. all those three things happened in Waco, Texas. Or, you know, about 5 miles out, 6 miles out in Elk, Texas.
Which nobody knows that. No.
Yeah.
No.
So it's associated with Waco, but it's actually in Elk.
You got to get your name on the list somehow.
Yeah. I mean, might as well. Mm. So 30 years ago. But before we go to, like, what happened on that day, we have to talk about how did they get here? Like, what brought the Branch Davidians and David Koresh, and how in the hell did they get to Waco, and how did it get to that point?
And who are these people?
Who are these people? So let's meet Vernon Wayne Howe, who we know as David Koresh. He was born in August of 1959 in Houston, Texas, so he is a Texan, to an unwed 14-year-old named Bonnie Clark, which I thought that was crazy because he later marries 14-year-olds. Maybe he felt guilty for his mom being an unwed 14-year-old, so he marries 14-year-olds. Who knows? By the time he was born, his father had already left his mother for another teenage girl. And by the time Vernon was 4 years old, his mama had left him. So there's a couple of, you know, early red flags.
Yeah, a little bit.
Mama had left him for a boyfriend, and he was being raised by his grandma, Earlene, Miss Grandma Earlene. So by the time he was 7, mom came back into his life, and she had found a new beau, and this will be his stepdaddy, and they had a kid together, and so he has a brother named Roger. Okay. So Vernon's mom described his childhood as lonely and kind of sad because Vernon was bullied in school. He did poorly in school. He had horrible grades. He had dyslexia, and he was in special education. So he ended up dropping out in 9th grade. I did not know this. At an early age, he was fascinated with the scripture and with the Bible. And at age 12, he began studying the Bible and listening to Christian radio stations. So I don't want to say red flag yet, listening to Christian radio stations. It is kind of weird that a 12-year-old is studying the Bible.
That engulfed, yeah.
But this might be, by the age 14, he had memorized the New Testament. And oh, Caroline, I don't know if you've ever held the Bible.
Listen, bitch. You know what I rememberize? I memorize. I know the 50 states because there's a song. I know the lyrics to Rihanna's Umbrella because I sing it all the time.
Listen,
but I
not
try to remember the damn encyclopedia. What is he even?
Listen, not the books of the Bible, like my song that I sang a couple episodes ago. The whole New Testament. And then by the age 18, he memorized the Old Testament. Now, the Koreshians.
I mean, I could do that if I wanted to, really tried.
Yeah. Now, the Koreshians, who will find that they actually would rather be called Koreshians instead of Davidians, and I'll kind of explain that here in a little bit, attested to him actually memorizing the Bible, like, because he would ramble off, and there's a lot of video out there of him, like, rambling off verse after verse after verse, page after page after page of the Bible, like he just knew it from front to back. Now,
wild.
I know, but especially back then, a lot of times dyslexia, it was hard for you to, like, sound out words. So when you learned what a word was, you memorized it. So it was easier for you to memorize, read by memory than like.
Nope.
Yeah. So many Koreshians, at age 19, he joined the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but he was exiled after he got a 15-year-old girl pregnant. But it wasn't just any girl, Caroline.
Oh,
it was the preacher's daughter.
Oh, there you go, David.
And, you know, he just couldn't just get her pregnant. He actually told the preacher that God had given her to him. So he said, "Preacher, God said She is no longer yours. She is mine. So preacher was like, be gone, exiled, excommunicated from the church. And his mom and his brother later said that he loved the church so much that he had a little mental breakdown after this. And so he moved to a farm in Chandler, and he would be seen praying outside for days and days at a time. Like, his brother would see him outside on a Wednesday at 2 o'clock, and then at Thursday at 5 o'clock, he'd still be in the same spot and same clothes praying with the Bible.
Sounds like Israel Keys.
Really?
Yeah. He could sit in one spot for hours without moving.
Isn't that crazy?
Very crazy. Yes.
That's a different type of discipline.
But this deep belief in these different religions, that is a lot about what we're talking about at Lori Daybell Vallow trial.
Cult-ish type stuff.
It is LDS hardcore. Mm. They're doing things at the temple, and that's not approved of, and all this stuff.
Yeah, so, yeah. I love it. I never, I'm sure you'll hear a lot of connections with mm-hmm. Vallow and some of the other cults that we did, because as I was listening, I was like, oh yeah, this is like Marshall Applewhite, or this is like mm-hmm. Children of God. So just definitely make those connections. Okay, so he was also an entertainer. See if you make this connection. So as he grew a little bit older, he taught himself how to play the guitar, and he became a rocker, and he played rock and roll music in a band, and he moved to California and lived in Hollywood and tried to become a famous rock star, cult leader, rock star, long hair, ring any bells?
Yeah, Jones.
Charlie Manson.
What's his name?
Jim. Was he a rock star? I don't know.
Charles Manson a rock star?
Yes, he tried to become a rock star and failed, so he became a cult leader.
Oh.
David Koresh's band name was Messiah Productions.
Oh, that's right. Remember
my business card?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So.
Oh no! I didn't know that about those.
Yeah.
About them.
So he did not actually become.
Well,
famous rock star.
Be famous.
And actually, when he came to Waco, he would be playing at local bars in Waco. So people in Waco remember him playing at local bars. Chelsea, people that have been here, Chelsea Street Pub, I think, was the place. And Richland Mall used to have a bar, and he would play there all the time. Mm. Okay, so just fun Waco fact. So in 1981 is when he actually came to Waco. And he joined a religious group called the Branch Davidians. So they're Seventh-day Adventists, and there's a branch of them called the Branch Davidians. So I was like, what does Seventh-day Adventists believe? Do you know? Me either. So thank you, author Dan Morris. He summed it up for me. They believe a lot of what we as Christians believe. They believe in the Trinity of God. They believe the Bible is God's word, okay? They believe God is the creator. Jesus is the Son of God. They believe that salvation is only through Jesus, who died for our sins. And then they believe that he is coming back, right? Mm-hmm. Now, we believe Sunday is the Sabbath day, so we go to church on Sunday. Mm-hmm. They believe it's Saturday.
Okay.
That's the biggest difference. They also don't believe in alcohol or tobacco.
But they do believe in firearms.
They do believe in firearms. Or David Koresh's branch does. And they do plant-based diets only, and they don't believe in hell. So that seven-day Adventist, I was like, oh, that's not too weird. That's nothing like the FDLS people.
Oh, gosh.
So this is, if you're going to join a cult or change religions, this isn't horrible.
I didn't find anything.
Yeah, I mean, let's go visit
their
church on Saturday.
They just go to church on Saturday instead of Sunday. I feel like that's the only difference. They sound like Catholics.
Do they sound like Catholics on Saturday? Catholics don't do anything on Saturday, do they?
Yes, Catholics.
Catholics believe in alcohol too much.
That's the only difference. Yeah, the alcohol. Because there is Catholic church on Saturday. My mom always goes every Saturday. She goes, that's when she goes to church.
So
Mass.
Let's talk about how the Branch Davidians started, because I thought Branch Davidians was named after David Koresh. Did you ever think that?
Well,
I'm the only one in the whole world.
No.
Somebody email me and tell me I'm not the only one.
I always was thinking, I remember it was Vernon David and then David Koresh. And I didn't know, I thought it was
Vernon Howe.
And I thought it was two people, but this is all the same person.
It's all the same person. He later changes his name.
He changes his name. And then I thought that I had read, I think back whenever, that there was like a history of this Davidians group or something, but I don't know too much about it, but he didn't create it. I know that there was somebody else that did, and then he just kind of swooped in and took over.
Yes, here we go. So in 1934, a guy named Victor Hotef called himself a messenger of God. He was living in California, belonged to a SDA, Seventh-day Adventist Church. He decided to take some of those people and bring them to Waco, Texas. And he bought a bunch of property near Lake Waco, and he called it Mount Carmel. So the first Mount Carmel is right over here by the lake. Mount Carmel in the Bible means holy mountain. Okay? Mm-hmm. So that's over there in the area where the Vanguard School is, and Salty Dog area. So this flock turned into like a small community, and they grew and grew and grew, and then slowly secluded themselves. And they had their own little city. They called it the Mount Carmel community. They had schools, they had banks, they had a store, they had nursing homes, they had an infirmary. So I picture it kind of like the Homestead Heritage out there.
Mm, could have been another cult.
It sounds like a cult. Homestead Heritage, very self-sustaining. They did not have to leave if they didn't want to. Homestead Heritage, right now off Golson Road, they do not have to leave. They have everything that they need right there. If they leave, it's because they choose to. So now he, Victor, in 1942, decided to add and name them the Davidians, which comes from the lineage of King David in the Bible. So that's where the Davidians came from. Okay. Now, 1955, Victor died. His wife Florence took over. And you know, anytime a woman gets put in charge,
it all goes to shit.
A man gets pissed.
Yep.
You know, because a man's like, we got the swinging wee-wee. It should be me. It should be me.
I feel like that's,
So, Benjamin Roden is like, I should have been head of Mount Carmel. So, he gets pissed.
No, he goes, I should have been head of Mount Carmel.
Should have been me.
It should have been me.
So, he takes a group of his flock, and he moves to Odessa, and he's like, I'm going to start my own Branch Davidian Church in Odessa.
Gone, boy.
Meanwhile, Florence is head, and she's like, Waco's getting too big. It's too many people. Let's move. So she sells the lake property and buys 941 acres east of Waco and calls it Mount Carmel. And that's what we know as the now compound. And that's how they get to Elk.
The compound.
The compound. So now we're at the compound that we know as a compound. But when she gets there, she gets a little crazy. Maybe that is like cursed land, because she starts getting divine revelations.
Well, so did Lori Vallow.
Did she predict the end of the world?
Oh,
why do they always predict the end of the world?
They were part of the 144,000 that were going to be the final survivors, and that these other people were zombies, and they had dark spirits, and so they were dark, and so they had to get rid of them.
Do they have a date, end of the world date?
No, but they just said that they had to get rid of them.
You know what's crazy?
They chopped them up and burned them and buried them.
Oh. I believe that Marshall Applewhite and Bonnie Nettles had an end of the world date, and I'm pretty sure it was April. Well, Florence had an end of the world date, and it was April 22nd, 1959.
Oh.
So she started preaching this, and she preached it for months and months and months. And people believed her. They sold hundreds of people. They sold their homes and they liquidated all their assets and they quit their jobs and they moved out there and they lived in buses and cars and tents. And some of them just like slept in trees and on the ground because you don't need anything when you know the world's about to end and all you're just going to go to heaven, Caroline.
Okay.
They stopped getting their nails did and their lashes done, and they're like, we don't need these worldly things.
No, they grew all their hair out. So
stop getting waxed and sugared.
Woo! Man, but they smell good.
She had about 1,400 followers at this time that just, like, gave her the money. And then April 22nd came. Some came up. Sun came down. Oh. World didn't end.
Oh, no.
And then they were like,
I got a new revelation. I got a new revelation.
Do you know?
It's 10 years later that this is going to happen.
You know.
Is that what happens?
No. Actually, Florence was like, well, maybe I ain't a good cult leader.
Florence gave up.
She threw the deuces and she was like, let me just sell this land. She sold all that acreage, but 77 acres of it.
Oh, God.
And she was like, I'm just going to retire. I'm not going to be a cult leader. Let me just take my money. And so
people,
because she lost a lot of followers, her words didn't have weight, whatever. So old Georgie boy that was pissed came back and he bought that land. And now he relocated his flock to the new compounds. And now he's got the old Davidians plus his Davidians. And now George Roden is the new leader of the Branch Davidian compound, Mount Carmel.
Mount Carmel.
And he stayed there until 1978. And then he died. So history, history, history. It's like man, woman, woman does screw some shit up, and then a man has to come take over. So when George dies, his wife takes over. He dies in 1978, and Lois takes over. Now, Lois is doing good until 1981 when an old boy named Vernon Howe joins. And Vernon Howe, who we know as David Koresh, is 21 years old. He was mesmerized by 64-year-old Lois's leadership abilities. He was like, man, she can get everybody to just give her all of their money. And she's just, everybody's just listening to everything that she says. And, you know, he was very charismatic because he was good on the guitar. He was the maintenance guy, kind of like a groundskeeper. And so they slowly start doing the dirty.
I was going to say, I didn't think that when you originally said Lois, I just pictured a guy.
It's a girl, yeah.
But then it's a girl, yeah. And then that's interesting.
So he kind of moves his way, so and he's 64. She is 64, he is 21, so it's like...
Oh, is she a MILF?
She is a MILF, she's a cougar, and this is totally opposite of what he has been doing his whole life. So you know he's being an opportunist. Right?
She's probably wanting him to be an opportunist.
Now, he gets her pregnant, supposedly.
What? She's 64?
She's 64, and he gets her pregnant with the Messiah.
Oh, of course.
So they start preaching. They start, everybody's
wait,
excited
bitch,
that
this
she's.
This is Immaculate Conception.
With the Messiah. And so they're all excited that the Messiah is going to be born. And then she has a miscarriage. Oh, and David's
just
like.
It was just a poop. She had the whole
She pooped. David was like, my sperm is just so powerful that she's already been through menopause, but I got her pregnant. She's the weak one. She didn't have enough faith to birth the Messiah. So then everybody starts thinking that she's not strong enough to lead them. And there is a George Jr. So Lois had a son. And, you know, George Jr. should be the heir of the throne, basically. And he's like, what's David doing moving in on my mama, trying to move in on my throne? He sees David, like, trying to take over. So him and David feud, and a fire is set. And nobody really knows if David sets the fire or if George sets the fire and blames it on David.
Like an actual fire?
A fire, like something at the compound. It's not called the compound.
It's not yet. Like a fake Letitia Stout fire. It's like an actual fire.
It's a fire. Something burns down and it's bad. And they blame it. George blames it on Koresh and some of his followers. So they get kicked out of Mount Carmel, escorted off the property, and banned.
Wow.
David Koresh is banned from Mount Carmel for a long time, for years. For years and years and years. So I was like, well, how does he get back? How does he get back? How does he end up coming there?
But then I figured you were going to go tell me.
Oh, no. Story ends. Done. Oh,
done. I found a piece of damn gum, and I can't find it. It's driving me crazy.
Dig. Okay, so Koresh is officially banished from Mount Carmel. And it's not called Mount Carmel anymore. It's called Rodinville because George is a narcissist. So Koresh moves to Palestine, and he is now officially like a cult leader still. He's just not a cult leader at Mount Carmel. He's like a traveling one. Like, he's got a people following him. He's got a flock. He is doing hours of Bible study daily. He's recruiting members. They live in abandoned buses and tents and in plywood huts. He has people pay him to travel to cities recruiting. He travels to other countries recruiting. And when we start talking about the members, we'll find out that members come from country, like, all over the world, not just like Central Texas or America, countries all over the world. And so he's wanting to grow his members because he has a plan, because he ultimately wants to take over Mount Carmel, as we know. So it's about 1986, okay? And David Koresh calls Detective Terry Fuller, who works for McLennan County Sheriff's Office. He's the one that gave me my business cards and took my book club on the tour. At the site out there. Now, David Koresh is tattletelling. He calls Terry Fuller and he says, hey, there is some meth labs out at Rodinville. Active meth labs, and they're selling meth to people of Waco, of McLennan County. And Terry's aware of the feuds from David and George. So he was like, you know what? I need some proof. Give me some proof. So Koresh is like, you know what? Let me switch up my plan. So he goes to the McLennan County Courthouse and he files this deed, a removal of trustee deed. And he takes George Roden's name off the property and he puts his name and lists himself as the president of the Branch Davidian Association.
Oh.
That's a little smart, I think.
Yeah.
He can't do anything. He's not doing anything with it yet, but he's like, let me just do this. And I got this over here for later on. Then he calls Detective Fuller again, and he's like, hey, Roden has now illegally exhumed a dead body.
What?
Mm-hmm. And Fuller was like, how do you know? He was like, yep, I know. I saw it with my own eyes. Her name is Ann Hughes. She was a former Davidian that died. She was buried on the body. He says he can resurrect it. He's trying to prove that he's the Messiah. If you go there now, he's trying to resurrect a dead body. And so Terry was like, I just can't go out there on that. I need some proof. So Koresh was like, I'm going to go get some proof. So him and seven of his followers, they dress up in army fatigue. They get their semi-automatic rifles, 3,000 rounds of ammunition, and they sneak on the property in the middle of the night. Well, they didn't realize George has an Uzi. So this is what we know as the battle, the shootout of Rodinville. Okay. They have a shootout.
I don't know anything about that.
I didn't either. Detective Fuller told us all
and
about
what's
this.
An Uzi.
An Uzi. I don't know. I thought it was on cartoons only. Bazookas and Uzis. I was like,
oh. I thought it was like an injury that was oozing.
Uzi is a Boo-boo? Like a machine type gun.
Oh. Feel free to let us know at correctioncorner.com.
Yep.
Or just leave us a one-star review.
It sounds real scary to me. So.
It sounded like I needed a Band-Aid, but that was about it. I don't know.
An Uzi. Yeah. When the police get called, and when they find George, he has 18 bullet holes in him, and he's leaning up against a tree.
Oh,
but
no.
But he's still alive.
18 shots?
Everybody gets arrested.
Good.
And there ends up being a trial in April of 1888. Okay?
What?
Now, there's different charges. George's on trial for exhuming a dead body, and he gets put in jail for a while. Now, David Koresh's whole thing is to try to keep George in jail. So him and his men gets that body of Ann Hughes in the coffin, and they walk it up to the courthouse steps,
resurrected,
and they walk it into the courtroom.
The
and
body
this
is
was
resurrected.
Proof to the judge and to the jury that George illegally exhumed a dead body in order to resurrect it. And so he was like,
you know, they
him
left
jail.
All this out in all the documentaries.
So this book, so the author of this book is an agent and was there like during the siege and during the shootouts. So much of this information, this footage was left out for years. And
yes.
Then it would, and even like the video footage, remember that they said was lost for so long?
I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyways,
it's just
crazy.
That's good info.
And that's why I wanted to read this book, because it is a lot of it was like never released information.
Ever.
Even like some of the new documentaries were never released information.
No, I've never heard any of this. But this is good.
It's crazy. And it just lets you know how crazy they both were.
Well, and it also shows you how much the media like makes up their own
hide shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Netflix and all that, you know, yeah, when they're doing it, they're not necessarily doing, they're doing based on a.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't include the parts that are going to make it, you know, seem legit or whatever. You're going to make it seem kind of outlandish, I guess.
Yes. Well, the body was not allowed into evidence, and because the body wasn't allowed to have evidence, the charges got dropped. George later admitted he did try to resurrect the body 3 times, but only because David challenged him to prove who the Messiah was. So what David did is he said, I am the Messiah. And George was like, no, I'm the Messiah. David was like, prove you're the Messiah. George was like, I will. George was like, if you're the Messiah, resurrect that body. Now, David knew he couldn't, but he knew George was crazy enough to do it. And he knew that as soon as he exhumed that body, he could call the police, get him arrested. And when he got put in jail, he could take over the land. And that's exactly what David did. And he had already gone down to the McLennan County Courthouse and had the deed changed over. So David was like, deal's done. So by the time George got out of jail, David and his people had already been moving their shit, his suitcases and everything.
These people who are cult leaders, they know they're full of shit.
And yeah, but it's worked and it's smart.
But they know that they are frauds. They know this.
Oh, yeah.
And then listen, I think the root to all the cult leaders is money. right?
Yes. Empower. I think that's why none of them ever kill themselves. You think about it. Like, all of them.
Marshall Applewhite.
He didn't kill himself. He had somebody else.
He didn't drink the Kool-Aid?
They didn't do Kool-Aid.
Oh, shit, I'm getting them all confused.
Jim Jones didn't even do it. Jim Jones had everybody else kill. But somebody
had to do it. Yeah.
Marshall Applewhite, somebody else did it for him. David Koresh, somebody shot him.
Manson was in jail.
Yeah, he died of a heart attack. David Koresh, somebody shot him. Like, they can't even
Gwen Shamblin, she done crashed in an airplane.
Yeah. So, anyways.
But with Valo, Lori Val, like, this is all what's happening right now. But it's the same thing. Like, she's doing a lot of these things for money, like getting her fourth husband killed. She was planning to get $1 million life insurance policy and was pissed that he had changed it the month before to his sister.
Smart.
But her two kids that she killed, they were on Social Security, so she was getting that. So everything, it's just all
money, power, money,
always
power.
Goes back to money.
Yep. Yeah, root of all evil.
The root.
Now, remember, David shot George, so he had to be tried for that. So he actually did go to trial for murder or attempted murder or manslaughter, whatever it is. And he had a jury, and the jury was hung. Like, it was declared a mistrial. And then, for some reason, the charges were dropped. So David was released, and he went back to the compound, and he started his reign as the official leader of Mount Carmel Center.
Dun, dun, dun. Join us next week for part two.
Yes, 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 yes. Part two. I actually will post a picture of David Koresh's mugshot because Detective Fuller gave us pictures of those. And then I had to ask the question is, what the hell happened to George Roden? Because he did get out of jail, and obviously he couldn't go home. George Roden had to go back to Odessa and live with a friend named Wayman Adair. Well, Wayman said...
Wait, Wayman or Raymond?
Wayman, okay. Literally.
I mean, I did used to say Wayman, so just making sure.
Wayman said the wrong magic word, Messiah. Wayman said that he was the Messiah. And Wayman. George was like, PTSD, I'm the Messiah. And
I'm the Messiah, Wayman.
He shot Wayman, chopped him in the head with an axe, went to trial, ruled insane, and was confined to a mental institution. What? He died in 1998 of a heart attack during an escape. So he got
him.
Now, you can listen to part two right now. If you click on the next episode, we will see you in part two. Don't forget to
stay aware,
stay alive,
and always be DTF.
Bye, y'all.
Bye.
Hey, y'all. This is April.
And this is Caroline.
And this is part two of your Waco Massacre 100th episode story of the Koreshians, Branch Davidians, David Koresh. Where do we leave off?
We left off at, I think he was just starting the the compound.
Yeah. He just
or
got
he was
there.
Just joining it.
He just got there. He had got rid of George Roden. He had proven that George Roden won the Messiah. And so now he's at the compound. And so Koresh was described as handsome with a sexy Jesus vibe. Do you see it? Do you see it? Please say no. And he was officially and legally has changed his name to David Koresh for business purposes.
Of course.
And also because David is a very royal name in the Bible, because of King David. And I think he wanted people to think that Branch Davidians was a branch of him.
The Davidians.
Yeah.
Davidians.
Yes. And maybe I was the only one that thought that, but I thought that. He was very charismatic, and he still loved music, and so he played music a lot, all the time, for his people. And remember, he was supposed to be a rock star like Manson, so him and Manson at the same time were going to be a rock star. They failed, and so now he's just trying to be Jesus, and so this is plan B for him. So his most notable song was ironically a song called A Madman in Waco, and they actually played it on the radio station here in Waco.
Wow. Okay.
But he wrote it about George Roden, his arch enemy. But people, you can find it on Spotify, and I may play it at the end. But when people hear it, you obviously, who do you think we think of?
Mm-hmm. Koresh.
Him, totally. So when David took over the compound, he started making some changes. He stockpiled weapons, of course, and ammunition. But for what? Like, what does a cult leader need all that for? They started to construct a new, he did some renovations, and he did not even need Chip and Joanna for this. It was not farm. Yeah, no, it wasn't farm chic. It wasn't like new modern. It was defensible, a fort like compound. It was big as a city block. He needed a concrete bunker and needed a 4-story tower with windows and holes in there.
Why does he need all these things?
He knew something was coming that nobody else knew was coming. He was predicting something was coming. So the building also had no air conditioning, no heat, and no indoor plumbing.
What?
So, ew. And except for Koresh's room. So, cult leaders, y'all are full of shit. Yeah. His room had AC, so probably like a window unit. And heat. And he had a television. And he had liquor. And he had all the other comforts that everybody else wasn't allowed.
Because, why couldn't they have it?
Well, he was the sinful Messiah. And he got to bear everybody's sins.
Oh. That's
for them. He was just that type of leader.
He's that type of leader, yeah.
Yeah. He took all that for them
He wanted to take on all the burdens
for them.
I mean, that's actually a good thing to do. Yeah.
Yeah. So by this time, he had been preaching that he was the modern day Messiah and everything belonged to him, but especially the women and the girls. Now, at age 25, he married a 14-year-old girl named Rachel Jones, just one of his wives. Won't be able to talk about all of them. And her parents were also members of the congregation, and they gave her their consent for him to marry her. And at Texas at this time, you could marry a 14-year-old if your parents gave your consent. So Koresh also had the power at the compound to annul marriages. So you and Dirty Chad could have just got to correction. He could have annulled your marriage, yeah, and you wouldn't have had to worry about lawyers or anything.
Well, that would have been nice.
That would have been much easier. Oh, yeah.
I would have definitely gone to him.
Yeah. You could have just joined, too, while you were there.
I probably would have.
That state of mind. So all the couples that joined got their marriages annulled, and then they were prohibited from having sex ever again. So people that were married for 20 years.
How do you grow your cult?
Oh, you could only David Koresh. Him. Yes. Oh, God. Either one, you were celibate. So men were celibate for forever. That's it. If you're a man, you're no longer allowed to get your wee-wee wet. Unless you're Koresh. And then if you're women, only women that were lucky enough to be chosen by God.
Mm-hmm. To bear the seed of the fruit.
Yeah.
Jesus and Holy Mary, Mother of God, for first sinners, not the hour of our death. Amen.
Oh, is that it?
Yeah.
I think that's what they said when they were there.
They did.
So, you know, the men would be rewarded in heaven for their celibacy. And then David would be rewarded because he needed 24 wives so that he can have 24 offspring. Yeah. And these 24 offspring would later rule later on. Oh, yeah. Now, at the end, we know that David had 19 wives total, so he almost made it. Like, we, damn that ATF, we interfered with his ultimate goal. And then he had 18 kids, and his wives were as young as 10 years old. That is third grade. It is third grade, and everybody at that compound thought it was okay, and these people who were part of that compound that are still alive now, still think it's okay. So if you watch the Waco Apocalypse, American Apocalypse, it's on Netflix right now. One of the girls, I can't remember her name. Her name does not need to be remembered. But she said, not a direct quote, but basically, he did nothing wrong because at 12 years old, you are a legal adult.
But these girls were 10.
Oh, so I don't know.
So then it's
okay or not okay? I don't know. At 12 years old, you're not an adult. At 10 years old, you're really not an adult.
Yeah, you're definitely not an adult at 12 years old.
When David's wives were divinely chosen, he didn't choose the ones that like he thought were prettiest or like had the biggest boobs or prettiest face. They were divinely chosen, Caroline, so you cannot call this lust.
No.
How dare you? They also got to wear a Star of David necklace, which I think is stupid because don't Jews wear that?
I think so.
David would exert power and mind control, and so he would randomly wake up in the middle of the night and implement these random stupid rules that they would follow. So, example, 4 o'clock in the morning, everybody wake up. Here's an air horn or some bells or whatever. And today's rule is you can only eat peanuts and bananas only all day. So everybody would just, okay. And then maybe the next day it's just apples and bananas. And then from now on, you're never allowed to eat apples and oranges together. You can only eat apples and bananas together.
Are these really rules or did you just make up an example?
No, these are rules that came from Christians.
They could only, okay.
Yeah, and you know, they're only plant-based diets, so you could only eat, you can't eat vegetables and fruit together.
What would happen only if they happened fruits. To have a peanut on the day that peanuts were not allowed and it was only apples and oranges?
You were publicly shamed. And whooped. And sometimes it was with the boat oar. Like, it's stupid. He would preach his sermons for hours long. He controlled every aspect of their life at the compounds, what they read, when they left, if they could leave. Kids had to be homeschooled, when they slept, how long they slept, what they ate, even their bathroom breaks, when they saw their family outside the compound. if you had to go to the bathroom during these hour and hours and hours long sermons, you could not, and you had to use it on yourself.
Oh, no.
He would exert physical punishment to teach people a lesson if they seemed like they did not.
Agree? Understand?
Yeah, or like were even paying good attention. And these sermons were videotaped. So you can there you could watch videotapes of these sermons, and you see these kids and these women and these men and these audiences watching and listening to these Bible studies, and they really do look like they're paying attention. But they would get beatings, and sometimes these kids would get beatings so bad that their bottoms would be bleeding. Women were not allowed to wear makeup or jewelry. Now, his sermon started taking a very dark turn, where he was preparing for the end of the world. Okay, now he would tell them all, and even the kids, they were preparing for a group of people to come in and kill them, and that they were probably all going to die. So little kids, these little kids, were hearing the sermon that people were going to come and invade the compound, and they're probably going to all die, okay? Mm. Also, the world was going to end, but because he's the Son of God, that any members who are there were going to reign. So if they do die, they're going to live again. But the people who left the compound were going to perish and go to hell.
Oh, no.
So that creates fear for people to never want to leave, right? Yeah. Now, one of the kids later says that when the ATF and everybody finally did come to the compound, that they didn't get scared. He had been preaching it for so long that it was just another day. Like, it was like, oh, okay, this is the day. It was like a fire drill at school, right? It's like, you've rehearsed it, you knew what to do. So when they showed up, they just kind of went to their spots like they were supposed to do and just waited for the end to happen. It was no big deal. Now, they were also, I thought this was crazy, knowingly in a cult. The Corinthians later said that they all agreed and knew that they were in a cult. And David told them, you know, this is a cult, but Jesus started a cult with his 12 disciples. So he takes what he, little bitty piece of the Bible, and refers it back to what he's doing and makes it all okay.
Wow.
Another piece of the Bible that he twists for his own purpose is the seven seals. Have you heard of the seven seals in the book of Revelation? So the book of Revelation, now seals is like a sealed document, not like the seal, the animal. But in this book, in the book of Revelation, there's these seven seals. These seven seals can only be opened by the Lamb of God. And you open these seals and there's just sacred documents in these seals. And that seventh seal, so basically only Jesus Christ can open these seals, right? And the revelation is the end of the world. So the book of Revelation hasn't happened yet. We know that when that happens, it is going to be end of the world. That's when Christ is coming back. That's like the apocalypse. That's when we're either going to hell or when we're going to heaven. Mm-hmm. Okay? So David Koresh says he can open the seven seals. He has that power. He is the Lamb of God. And that is why he is here on earth. Like, his job is to kick off this apocalypse.
Good for him.
Okay, so all his followers believe this, and that's why they are there with him. Because when he opens that seventh seal, they want to be able to go to heaven with him and not perish. Now, these are not like just dumb people. These are Waco attorneys. These are people that had businesses and money and education from all over the world and all over the countries, all races. Every single race and ethnicity and socioeconomic background was a part of this cult. Australia, New England, New Zealand, they're from Hawaii, they're from Texas, they were from everywhere. So really nobody outside of this cult could have pointed fingers and said, oh, you know, that's just that's just poor people, or that's just white people, or that's just, especially black folks, because we're the first ones to say, oh, no, white folks, that's white folks shit. Do you know there are so many black folks in this cult? I was so shocked to see how many black folks were in this cult. So we can't say that. When a member joined, they had to sell all of their assets, everything. So Caroline, if you joined, you signed a bequeathment certificate. And it basically, first you had to sell your house, and then any other assets, if you had a trust, if you had any Roth IRAs, any retirement, everything, sell it all, sign this bequeathment certificate, and that signed all your money and your possessions over to the Branch Davidian Association. Guess who's the president of the Branch Davidian Association?
David.
David Koresh.
So he bequeathed everybody.
He bequeathed.
Wow, that's impressive.
Yeah.
That's impressive.
Not to get that word mixed up with another.
No, I don't know. What, yeah. Yeah. No. But this is very much like what Warren Jeffs did, you know.
Did they sign something like that too?
Well, they just had to sell off all their property in order to move to the Zion or whatever. That yes. big, huge
At least it was beautiful.
Like, yeah, this one. It was that was a palace. Trailer house looking like.
Yes.
They must obviously have a lot more money, a lot more followers.
Warren, I mean, if you put him on a pedestal, Warren Jeff was a little bit more successful. Did he reign longer? I don't think his reign was very long.
I think it just because it had already been in, like they had already had the cult for so long, I guess. Or they already had this big following. So it's not like with David, it's almost like it was kind of newer.
It just hasn't really got established. And then everybody that established it, they were all minimalist. Like, they all expected people to live in tents and buses and, like, a little trailer. Even now, if you go out there, the bus lady's
up
there.
The bus is back.
Yeah. Now, if you go out there, there's, like, trailer houses and, like mobile homes and stuff. So they're still very much minimalist, which makes me think that the head person just likes to keep the money for themselves. Mm. So they're extra selfish. So he used this Book of Revelation apocalypse story to fuel what's going to actually happen, or what we know actually happens. So he uses the apocalypse and the analogy of it. So instead of God and Satan and the war of the apocalypse, it's going to be them and the government. So they are the God, and then Satan is the government. And so,
I mean, he's not wrong.
And so that's what their mindset is when they are going through this siege that we're going to talk about here in a little bit. So this leads me to know that, one, David knew that he was doing wrong, because he knew there were going to be some police officers knocking on his door here real soon. So let's talk about the investigation, because he is doing what he is doing for a while and nobody knows. Like, nobody knows David Koresh is, they know there's this religious group out there, nice religious group, and they know he goes and sings in town a little bit, and that he's just a little weird, but they don't know yet that he's annulling marriages and impregnating little girls yet. They just think he's this weirdo.
So what's their reasoning for doing any, or
this is how they're about to find out.
Okay, so
around the end of March of 1992, and remember, it starts in 93. So we're about a year before the knock on the everything happens. Mm-hmm. So a UPS delivery guy who has been delivering to the compound for a while, he's making just routine deliveries. Well, these routine deliveries that he's always made, he stops delivering to the compound, and he starts delivering to another building at the Magbag location on Elk Road. So, Waco people, Caroline, you live in Hewitt, right? So, when you get on 6, and 6 turns into Loop 340, and that loops you all the way around to Belle Mead, right? Mm-hmm. Before you get into Belle Mead, there's a road called Elk Road, okay? And when you turn on Elk Road, there is a big building called, I don't even know what it's called, but it's a big blue building. That is the Magbag location. That is where Corishians used to keep a lot of their weapons. They would, that was a business. It was like a fake automotive repair. It was a fake gun shop repair. So they would have all these things delivered there like it was a business, but it was supposedly, it was really them stockpiling weapons for their war. Oh
my gosh.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now, so this UPS delivery guy was like, for some reason, I'm not going straight to the compound anymore. I'm stopping here. So he would stop there, which is just 5 or 6 miles from the compound. He would stop there, and somebody would meet him out. They would check him out. They'd call Koresh on the phone, and Koresh would have to give him the green light. And then they would, this UPS guy would follow another Koreshian down to the compound. They'd let him in the gates. And now these nice religious guys are wearing army fatigues, and there's security guards at the gate. This one day, he picked up a box and an empty grenade fell out.
Mm-hmm.
So he just stuck it back in there, gave him the box, and like was deuces. And these boxes were bigger and they were heavier. So when he goes home and he tells wifey, you know, we just don't play. We're like, this is weird. Like these religious people are weird. It'd be like if my husband had delivery at the Homestead Heritage. I don't trust the Homestead Heritage.
Yeah, so the UPS guy was delivering this package, and then at what point did this grenade fall out?
When he was picking up a box, there was a hole, and I guess there was a hole, or the box was damaged.
Uh-huh.
A lot of times boxes are damaged.
Yeah.
And so it fell out, so he just kind of picked it up and put it back in there. Didn't let them know that he knew.
Yeah.
And then he just told his wife and didn't say anything.
He's like,
yeah.
Oh, look what happened to me today.
Yes. Okay. His wife calls McLennan County Sheriff's Office.
And she's like, my husband delivered a package and it had a grenade in it?
Yes, but it was an empty grenade. So it wasn't like, it was empty. So the sheriff's office is like, what? And they call the ATF. And so they're talking to the ATF, and there's an undercover ATF agent, and they see that there are, so they start looking at all these deliveries that have been made for weeks and months and months and months. And they see, oh, this isn't their first delivery. They've been getting deliveries for forever with gunpowder, black powder that goes, it's all the stuff that goes inside the grenades, just anything that you need for a war. Like, it's not an army base, but anything an army base might need, mm-hmm. and more. And so they get an undercover agent to go and make the next delivery with the UPS guy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So they make the next delivery, and David Koresh makes them because he's a smart guy.
Mm-hmm.
And the undercover agent is stupid. He like is like, can I use your bathroom? Can I use your phone? He just does things outside of the norm that a normal UPS delivery guy doesn't do. So he picks up the phone, David Koresh. When they leave, he calls the McLennan County Sheriff's Office and he says, I know you're trying to infiltrate the compound and it's not going to happen. So that, along with David Koresh's paranoia and his apocalypse mindset, makes him order even more. So after that, he orders 143 more assault rifles, more ammo, more weapons, and he's getting ready for even more, okay?
Oh.
So by July of 1992, Koresh and the Branch Davidians are officially under investigation. And Special Agent David Aguilera, like Christina, file a report for illegal possession, manufacturing, and conversion of weapons and explosives. Okay? So that's why David Koresh is now on the ATF's radar. They're also, so they're trying to get a search warrant, basically, so that they can go and serve them a search warrant. Mm-hmm. So they want to go to that Magbag location mm-hmm. that was at the end of Elk mm-hmm. Road. And they want to search the compound. Okay? So in episode 3, they obtain a search warrant. And we're going to go through how they go and implement that search warrant mm-hmm. that leads to the actual them being on the compound steps. If you want to listen to that now, all you got to do is press next, because episode 3 is there for you right now. If you don't have time, you can listen to it later. It's already there. All right, y'all. We will see you in episode 3. Don't forget to
stay aware,
stay alive,
and always be DTF.
Bye, y'all.
Bye.
Okay. Hey, y'all. This is April.
And this is Caroline.
And we're back.
We're back.
This is part three of your still 100th episode. Caroline, what are you thinking right now? Like, if you worked for the McLennan County Sheriff's Office and, like, ATF, where would your head be right now? Would you be like, just let them do what they do over there?
I guess you got to go by the amount of stuff that they have ordered and have stocked away.
Yeah.
Because if it's a lot of, like, explosive stuff and a ton of guns, I mean, I would be a little concerned. Yeah.
Yeah. We'll kind of learn a little bit more about that during this episode because Agent Aguilera is DTF, and so he's finding out more and more, and maybe this will give us a little bit more insight into why we actually did go to them and raid. So Agent Aguilera, in my opinion, was DTF. He was down to fine. He was doing some more investigation because this, it still could be some circumstantial evidence, right? Mm-hmm. They don't actually have any weapons that they've seen. They have paperwork of weapons, and then they have a business that could be a fake business that it's a firearms dealer at the mag bag, whatever location. So there's a man named Henry McMahon. He's out of Hewitt, and he is a licensed firearms dealer. He sold guns. And turns out he sold guns to David and to a lot of the Christians. And so Agent Aguilera went to go interview him in Hewitt, Texas, and found out that he bought 39 other firearms and 65 AR-15 lower receivers. So he bought the top part of the gun delivered with the UPS guy. He bought the lower part of the receiver from this Henry McMahon guy, and that's an assault rifle, and they were trying to kind of ask questions about Koresh, and he was like mouth sealed. What we later found out is Henry McMahon called up Koresh when they left and warned Koresh that the ATF is on to him. So that adds a little bit more paranoia mm-hmm. into Koresh. Okay, now Agent Aguilera also interviewed neighbors because they have 77 acres over there, but there's still a ton of other people in Elk and on Double E Ranch Road where the compound is. And one neighbor was former military. Well, you know, former military, they know what the sound of automatic weapons fire sound like and semi-automatic weapons. And he told them that every night he sees about 20 men dressed up in fatigues at the compound shooting at human-shaped silhouette targets. They're having shooting practice. Mm-hmm. They're practicing as if they were in the military.
Oh, no.
He also starts to interview former members of the group and anyone who has relatives in the group. He finds the Andrades, okay? They still have two daughters in the group who are at the compound and who are both married to Koresh. And this is when they find out there's some pedophilia going on.
They
find out the daughters are very young of age and that one of them is pregnant by Koresh. And that's when they find out that men, that he annuls marriages and that men have to be celibate. So Aguilera is like, what? It is. It goes deeper and deeper and deeper. He meets the Bund family, who also left the compound, and they co-signed on the pedophilia, on the annulments, and also said that he has fathered at least 15 kids at the time that they left, and that most of his wives were younger than 16 years of age, and that he was actively making a hit list to eliminate all prior members who left.
Oh, God.
So now there's a supposed hit list with their names on there. A member named Payo Viga, she tried to leave and was physically restrained, like tied down, handcuffed, for 3 months before being allowed to leave. Grace Adams said she was being held in a solitary confinement for 4 months, being fed on the floor from a bowl, was slapped around by Koresh before she was allowed to leave. And then other members confirmed sex weapons, 50 caliber weapons and bullets, AK-47s, AR-15s, 9mm pistols, street sweepers, and 12-gauge shotguns, and more.
It's a lot of weapons.
Yeah. Like, regular police departments and SWAT teams, like, I don't even think they're allowed to have these types of weapons.
I don't, yeah.
What's
a street sweeper? I don't know. Like, a Nelly song or something.
I thought that kept the streets cleaned.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Maybe they needed it to, I don't know what they would use it for, but it's a lot of weapons.
So he takes all this back to his people and his higher ups and ATF and everybody. And so they have to call CPS about the pedophilia. Okay. This is going to make you real proud. We know how you feel.
I'm a big fan of CPS.
We know how much confidence you have in CPS, Caroline.
CPS probably went in and they probably joined and were like, oh, screw these kids. We're going to go join the cult.
They did a full investigation.
I bet they did.
Full.
How full was it?
A caseworker named Joyce Sparks visited the compound several times in 1992.
And found nothing wrong with the living situations of pregnant 12-year-olds.
With no running water.
With no running water, no AC in Texas.
She was carefully escorted on a stage, and this is her words, on a stage tour, but ultimately could not find any evidence to back up the child abuse or sexual abuse charges against Koresh or anyone else in the compound.
Wow, because usually they can find any reason to file these charges against any parent. And then they get to put them in foster care and they make money. So I don't understand what's happening.
Good job, Joyce Sparks.
Way to go.
But she did see trap doors, secret doors, underground pits.
That's totally normal.
And David Koresh did ramble on about the end of the world, the apocalypse, and how she should actually just stay.
Yep. And here she goes. She's going to stay. Watch.
No. or that's not part of it.
He gave it a good try. Yeah. He gave it a good effort. I'm not mad at him for it, but.
So, I mean, she closed the CPS case, but she did go to ATF and say, hey, there's some weird guns and ammo, and but the children are all safe.
The children are safe, never mind the dungeons and you know, the pregnant 12-year-old walking right past you, but everything's fine with the kids.
CPS, this really helped you guys out. Ooh, this really helped y'all out.
I don't think they're trying to get any help.
So it's 1993, it's January, so it's been a 1992, a full year of investigation and finding out all this stuff that I just kind of summed up. It's 1993, it's January, and they want to get closer, and they want to get surveillance on the compound. So 8 undercover agents rent a house near the compound, and they call it Sierra One. Mm-hmm. 8 male undercover men agents rent a house near the compound. They call it Sierra One. Undercover, 8 grown-ass men. Guess who? Knows in 20 seconds, Koresh. Because what grown-ass 8 men are going to live together and it's not a frat house?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So he knows it like in a second, but they don't know that until like later on. So they're like on the roof and they're like on the binoculars and their job is to see their routine. Like what time do they get up in the morning? When are they shooting at night? What are the women doing at certain times of the day? Where are the kids? Can they figure out where they keep the guns? Where are the men? Like, just what their routines are. And they do that.
It's almost like they should have, you know, had one of their own go and be a part of the cult.
How smart are you? Because Detective Rodriguez does do that.
Wow.
He doesn't totally join, but Koresh invites outside people to come to their Bible studies all the time. So Detective Rodriguez comes to Bible study a lot,
mm-hmm.
right down the road. And these are not like hour and a half Bible study. It's like Black church times 45. Like you have 4 hour and 5 hour.
It's a lot of
4 or 5 hour Bible study every day.
These people have attention spans, I guess. Like that's a big one.
4 and 5 hour every day.
I feel like maybe though, whenever you get in there, you kind of are like, well, they're not so bad.
Well, and I would be so mesmerized when I went there and I recorded that guy, Charles Pace, I think his name was Charles Pace, who's over it now. I could have just listened to him just to like, just try to fill him out and see how crazy he really is.
Mm-hmm.
So for this guy, he was like, anything he says could be helpful in this investigation. So I probably would have loved that job. It did get dangerous for him later on. So they did kind of do that where he would attend Bible study. Now, they had all this information, right? They had a bunch, but it was not enough to actually just go in and arrest Koresh. They needed actual evidence, so they had to get this search warrant so they can see those actual weapons, obtain some weapons. But how would they search the property, especially since they know they have all these weapons?
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, this is them in a planning meeting. Like, they have a board. They're, like, around the table. And they're like, you know what? Let's rule out a siege. We cannot do a siege. A siege cannot happen. It's too dangerous. It could end in a mass suicide. Reasons not to have a siege. It could end in a mass suicide. It could last a very, very long time. I don't know. Find it. It could last a very, very long time. And because they're used to living minimally, that we couldn't take anything away from them.
Mm-hmm.
What is it? What do you see?
A siege is a military blockade of a city or fortress with the intent of conquering by attrition or a well-prepared assault.
Well, and so like sometimes during a siege, they'll like turn off their water, turn off their electricity, but they already don't have any of that. So so that's why they're like, it would last too long.
So they try to kind of handicap them.
Yeah.
To go for.
And then so they were like, this could also be so expensive on the government because it could last so long because they already live so minimally. So They're like, siege out of the question. Let's not do a siege. They also knew if they just went in there and served the search warrant by force, that it could develop into a siege. So they were like, we know siege could be like a plan B. Like, we don't want to just go in thinking, let's go in and do a siege.
Mm-hmm.
But it could develop into a siege. So they requested those big Bradley vehicles from the Department of Defense. Which is, I think, those big old tanks. They also decided, let's do dynamic entry. And so that is just basically, they're going to enter the structure and they're going to quickly overwhelm them. Opportunity, like surprise, the element of surprise.
Yeah.
So they're going to go in at a time. Like wee hours of the morning.
Okay. This one says it's a military operation that surrounds a town and cuts off essential supplies.
Yeah, yeah.
With the aim of compelling the surrender of those inside.
Yeah, you want them to like just come out, hands up, and surrender.
What's wrong with doing a siege?
Well, they just said that it would be expensive.
Okay.
Because they already live minimally. What are you going to take away? They already live without everything.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So it would last for forever. Plus, this is a cult.
Mm-hmm.
Cults in the past end in mass suicide.
Right.
So what did Jen Jones do? What did Marshall Applewhite and them do? So if you bring on a siege, they just may do their suicide routine. And so they didn't, you would give them an opportunity to drink the their Kool-Aid or whatever their ending is.
Yeah.
So there, which is, I feel like they were thinking out all the options and they were right. Siege would not be the first thing. So dynamic entry was their way to go. We're going to go in. Mm-hmm. We're going to go in quickly. We're going to overwhelm them. We're going to surprise them. We're going to deny them the opportunity to even grab a weapon or resist. And so now they have to find the best time to do that. Okay, so usually when they do stuff like this, they do this at the crack of dawn when they're sleeping. They catch them like in the bed before they even get out of the bed, right? But since they've been stalking them, that Sierra One house has been watching them, they knew that if they go mid-morning at like 10 a.m., since they've been watching them, they knew that the men are all in this certain area at this time of the day near the compound working in a bit, in the pit. They knew that the women and the children were secured at school, like in the tower or something, and that David Koresh was usually alone at this time. They thought that they knew they kept the weapons like in the underground bunker, and so they had, they had a plan, right? Yeah. It would be no confrontation. Everyone would be safe. They would go. They would present their search warrant, get their evidence, make an arrest, and like deuces. Okay? Mm-hmm. Plan.
Great plan. Good plan.
Great plan. They had about 75 agents. They had agents coming from Houston, from Louisiana, from Austin. And they had a headquarters. They were setting up shop at TSTC, Texas State Technical College, where Kenneth McDuff, if you listen to episode one, went to school. And then they were like, element of surprise. They can't see us coming. We know that the Koreshians sometimes go into town. If we drive a Loop 340 and we go there in armored vehicles, somebody's going to see us and somebody's going to tip them off. So they're like, what can we do? What can we drive? What can we go in? We got 75 ATF agents. How can we do this?
And how big at this point was this in the news? Because I'm thinking like
right nobody now- knew. Nobody knew. It is element of surprise. It can't be in the news or you will not surprise them.
Yeah, but we don't know about any kind of a compound that's out there or like there's no, I guess we don't.
No.
Because I was thinking if this, if something like this was happening now, I was like, man, if only we were doing this back then, and you like you go out there.
Yeah.
But
that was the whole thing. It's like you knew that there was a weird religious cult out there. You knew David Koresh was weird, but you had no idea what was really going on.
Oh my gosh.
So instead of taking armored vehicles out there and police cars and all this stuff, they decide to get cattle trailers, and they put 10 to 12 agents in the back of each cattle trailer. They cover their agents up in tarps.
Oh my god.
They go out to the they're like, let's go out to the compound in cattle trailers.
Oh my gosh.
They won't see us coming because it's Texas and you see cattle trailers going down the road all the time. It's okay. Elk, Texas. That's near Axtell. It's a lot of land out there, like there's cattle. Nobody's going to think of any, you know. This is them planning it out still. They're not doing it yet. They even planned to send a lookout guy first, just a random guy driving in a truck. He was going to drive down the road before anybody went, take a look at the compound, make sure there was nobody out with weapons, make sure the windows, you didn't see any guns like hanging out the windows. And when he saw that it was safe, then they were going to come. Because if you haven't been out to the compound, once you actually turn into the gate, to the compound, you drive about maybe 250 yards, and then you have to L to get to the compound. Mm-hmm. And then there's no way out. So once you drive there, there's no way out. So once you're there, you're there.
Mm-hmm.
You're trapped.
Yeah.
It could be mass casualties if something goes wrong. know. Here's the crazy part is the only plan they had if something went wrong was to abandon ship, so abandon these cattle trailers and run in a zigzag motion back to the main road. And they called this the old ship plan. Caroline, that was the extent of plan B.
That, you know what? Those sounds like plans I like to make. Run in a zigzag line.
To dodge the bullets.
To dodge the bullets.
They called it the old ship plan, and that was the extent of plan B. Like, they had plan A.
Definitely a bunch of men came up with this plan.
Don't you? There needs to be a woman a part of every single
operation. 100%.
They had the logistics down, but they didn't. There was no problem solving going here.
Yeah, you need a little finesse, okay?
Oh, I hate it. But also, the agent that wrote this book,
deeper in your planning,
Dan Moore said every plan ever in the ATF, there's never been an evacuation plan. It's never been thought of.
Why would they think of that? Yeah.
Yeah. Why would you ever think of a plan B or evacuation plan? That's, to me, that's big headed. That's like, oh, everything's going to be 100% perfect. Yeah, like we're never going to get it wrong. They also originally planned to post snipers up, you know, just in case they needed it. Mm-hmm. But they decided not to because I guess they didn't think that they needed it and they later would regret this decision. Now, for the past couple of months, ATF agents and the Waco Trib had been meeting because the Waco Trib and the news and the ATF have been investigating Koresh because people are kind of now knowing a little bit, but not like the community as much. Mm-hmm. It's more like CPS knew, so then the Waco Trib knew, so then, you know, like it's a little bit of town talk, but not that much. It's not, no articles have been put out yet.
Like we wouldn't be going out there. Nope,
not yet. But the Waco Trib, like their mouth is watering. They're ready. Oh, yeah. They've had this article written since December.
Yeah.
But the ATF was like, you can't. McLennan County Sheriff's Office is like, you can't. You're gonna ruin this. You're gonna tip them off. You're gonna ruin the investigation.
Yeah,
hold it. Yeah. So they had one last meeting, and at this meeting, they were like, yes, we are about to serve this warrant. Hold your article. You're gonna serve this warrant. As soon as we serve this warrant, you can release your article, right? Mm-hmm. So they all shook hands and they all left. Again, there had to have not been a woman at that meeting. Because they all left and nobody
knew.
Has set a date. Popos didn't say, we're going to serve the warrant on this date.
Like, oh, wait. We're going to release the article. Waco, you didn't tell us the date.
Yeah, and Waco Trib didn't say, when can we release it or when we're going to release it.
The media should have just been like, we are releasing this at this time and this time, so if you're going to do it before.
Do it before this, yes. Or police should have said, do not do it before this. Yeah. Somebody should have threw out a date. Nobody threw out a date.
That's why I need a female.
So guess what? Waco Trib published an article, part one, called The Sinful Messiah on February 27th, 1993. When did day one happen?
I don't know.
The next day, February 28th. But only because
they dropped this article.
The ATF was going to do it that Monday on March 1st.
Well, they should have told them.
They should have fucking told them.
They should have told them.
Well, guess what? Damn Koreshian saw the article.
DTF.
And showed it to David Koresh. David Koresh was calling Waco Trib, calling sheriff's office because this made him look horrible. He was trying to like save face. This is not true. They met at the ATF at headquarters at TSTC, and they were like, "Should we not? Did this take away our element of surprise? Mm-hmm. Should we not do this?
Well, you got to do it now.
Did we?" jeopardize Operation Trojan Horse. I forgot to tell y'all that's what it's called.
No, you did. You said Trojan, I think.
During the break.
Yeah.
Operation Trojan Horse, okay? And so they had somebody read thoroughly through the article, and it said nothing about them being investigated legally, just CPS. So the Koreshians can read the article and see that the article said nothing about sheriff's office, ATF, guns, or anything. So the police, the ATF, Trojan Horse people were like, well, it didn't really out us.
Yeah.
But David Koresh's
mind goes there because he's paranoid.
Yeah, and he's already done called him.
All this stuff.
He's already, and he knows the Sierra house is over there. He knows he's already done undercover. He's already done called the McLennan County Sheriff's Office, said, I know you're trying to infiltrate. So anyways, they go the next day.
Lord.
Okay. All the logistics were taken care of. They were ready. They are not going to cancel Operation Trojan Horse. They said they still have no idea that we're coming. They don't know when we're coming. We're going to go. Except this is a small town. Okay? Small town Waco. And arrangements had to be made and accommodate the ATF, right? They had 153 hotel rooms that needed to be booked because people were coming in from all over. They needed ambulance services booked and on standby. They needed coffee and donuts for the...
Who is taking care of all these logistics?
That's when they bring in the women.
Yeah, that's
make
when
these phone calls. The they rented the Bellmead Civic Center.
I mean, this is a lot of work.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're planning an event.
It's an event. Yeah. The National Guard was called. They had an explosive specialist. Like, people were coming to Waco, and word got out, and a local news person found out. Okay? Local news person, there was two ways they got tipped. I saw somebody from a local police department tipped them off, and then I saw another that an ambulance person tipped them off. Either way, a local news person's got tipped off. So, the day of, okay, I was just making sure I wasn't getting ahead of myself. Okay, a local news person's found out. So it is February 28th. They moved it back to that. It's 8:30 a.m., and a news reporter is lost on the side of the road heading towards Elk Road, right? She's lost, and she pulls over on the side of the road. She's trying to make a phone call, and another person pulls over in a U.S. mail truck, and he asks if the person is lost. And the reporter says, yes, I'm looking for directions to Rodinville. And the mail guy is like, oh, yeah, those Davidians, they are weird. I read that article. And the reporter says, yeah, well, be careful. There's some type of law enforcement action going on today, so I'm going out there.
Oh, no.
The mail guy was David Koresh's brother-in-law.
I knew it.
One of the mighty men. So he flew to David, told him. David was given a 14-hour sermon or something. And that undercover that has been there, Agent Rodriguez, was in that sermon when he found out. And, you know, David had known this whole time, he'd been going there for weeks, that he was undercover. And in the middle of that sermon, he looked at Rodriguez and he says, the ATF are coming. He shook his hand and he said, good luck to you. And he showed him the door. And Agent Rodriguez turned around and walked out, and he waited because he's just like, I just knew I was going to get shot in the back. And he said that he did not breathe until he walked off. When he walked off and finally got off the premises, he went to Sierra House and then called the ATF, and he says, they know. David knows that we're coming. He called the command center. David knows that we're coming. So right then and there at 9 o'clock a.m. on February 28th, they were supposed to show up 1 hour later. They lost the element of surprise that their whole plan was based on.
Oh, no. Oh, my gosh.
And because of that, a fourth of their group would be killed or injured within 1 hour, and the rest would be fighting for their lives. Yes, within 1 hour. And then bitch is about to be 1 hour late because they know. No. So ATF is over here getting ready because they're supposed to show up at 10. That's the plan. Back at the compound, David and them have been ready for this for forever. They go throw on their black clothes, their bulletproof vests. They're carrying their rifles. The women and the children were told to go upstairs and go lay down, lay on the floor. The other Carishians were arming themselves with 9mm pistols, their hand grenades, their semi-automatic and automatic assault rifles, their machine guns, their 50 caliber rifles. They had assumed their assigned positions that they had been practicing in the window and in their trapped doors and other locations, and they sat back and they waited for their apocalypse that they had been waiting and preparing for. Dun, dun, dun.
What was even the point of that detective to go in there?
Rodriguez?
Yeah.
To see if during any of these Bible studies, will David release some information about a plan? When? Because they were thinking this whole time that they would go into the community and assault the community, or that they had a big mass suicide plan. So that was the ATF's thinking this whole time, and sheriff's office is either one, they're going to mass suicide and kill all these women and children themselves, like cults do, or were they planning to use these weapons to go in and kill them? To go and kill people, innocent people in the community. Yeah. And that's why they wanted to go out there. So they were hoping that this person would hear that, and nothing like that came up. But it was total opposite. When he was preaching about the apocalypse, everybody that was an original Christian knew that that was code. That code language was government and them. But he was using the word Satan and God and whatever. So Agent Rodriguez would have never really been able to put it together till later on.
Poor guy.
Poor guy, poor guy, poor guy, poor guy. Okay, so what are you thinking now? I mean, we know how it's going to end, but, you know, Waco's about to come, ATF is about to come in. Are you scared for them?
No.
No?
Mm-mm. I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
You don't know what's going to happen?
Well, I do because I watched it in second grade, but I don't know what I would have thought.
Okay. So, part 4 is the last part you're going to get and for today for this episode. And it starts off the actual Operation Trojan Horse. Now, in Dan's book, he goes through, if, like, you were interested in play-by-play, like, minute-by-minute, the whole thing. I am very much summing it up for you. I'm going to go through the highlights of that and kind of how it went down up until the ceasefire on part 4. Next week, you'll be able to get the ending, and kind of the aftermath of that. All right, y'all.
Love it.
Don't forget to
stay aware,
stay alive,
and always be DTF.
Bye, y'all.
Goodbye.
Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the
No, I'm better at watching sports on TV.
Not in person. You don't like going to football games?
I do, but I don't get the same out of it. Like, I feel like I can pay attention more watching it on TV. Because they're telling you what's happening.
Uh-huh.
Whereas when I'm watching it, I'm like, well, what just happened?
When, or yeah.
Like, you know, they kind of do a play-by-play. Otherwise, I don't know.
When I'm there, I watch the screen, but I don't know what's going on either way.
Yeah, it's hard to know. It's, yeah. I mean, baseball, it wouldn't be hard to know, but like with football.
It's just so slow. And then you go to these, and they're like 4-hour games, and the score's 2-4.
Yeah, it's.
No.
Only if you know somebody, I think it's more obviously more exciting.
Yeah, but they're on the, they bat like once in the whole, or twice.
That's real bad. Oh, we were just talking.
No, no, we already recorded. Yeah, yeah, oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay, you're still good.
Yeah. Sorry. What? Sorry. South Park.
Grape.
Okay. Let's finish this thing. Hey, y'all. This is April.
This is Caroline.
Part 4, Waco Massacre. This is Operation Trojan Horse.
Is your mouth watering?
Trojan, not condom.
No condoms here.
I had no idea what was going to happen. I had no idea the details of the siege. I just remember watching like clips of what you would see on the news over and over. The same things that they would play over and over.
One dude going in the window, on the roof, and then all of a sudden he like falls off the roof and then there's fire.
Yep. All the... I remember seeing like the tanks crash into the house. I remember seeing the four-wheelers and go-karts lined up outside. But I didn't know. And then you just hear everybody's story. Here's a little bit of what happened. Definitely can't tell it all. Here's a little bit of the parts that I thought was important. So, remember from episode 3, 9 a.m., Koresh gets word that the ATF are coming. Agent Rodriguez goes back and he calls command center, and now they have to express everything that they're going to do in the next hour. They're supposed to show up at 10 a.m. They show up at 9:46 a.m. So they get to be about 15-ish minutes early. Meanwhile, back at the compound, the Koreshians have had a whole hour to get ready. In addition to the 3 years that they've been getting ready. So they continue to, with their plan, they have their trailers and they pull onto into the gate, onto the driveway. And once you pull in, like I told you earlier, there's no turning back because there's not like a quick exit to get out. This is not like a paved driveway. This is like dirt roads and it's potholy. So the cattle trailers are hitting. Soon as they get in and they go around that little L shape, the windows of the compound start coming up. There's like cutouts in the buildings, like where it looks like it was just like a building, but then it comes out and it's like a trap door. Those come open and guns come out. And they realize these Koreshians are not working in the yard or in the pit or doing homeschool with the kids. They are waiting patiently to ambush. And it literally starts to rain bullets. So they had helicopters that at during their initial plan, they were supposed to come in and just kind of create a like a diversion and add more shock and scare. Well, now they needed these helicopters to come and like provide some support. And the helicopters get hit by heavy gunfire, forcing them immediately to retreat, Caroline. Two of them almost go down immediately, so they all three have to take it back to the command center almost immediately. So three helicopters provide no support. Their careful, thought-out plan was based on the element of surprise, and that was ruined. They were the ones that were surprised. Guy named Agent Balestros makes it to the front door to serve the warrant. Koresh is at the front door. He says, "What's going on?" Balestros says, "It's a search warrant." Koresh slams the door in his face. Bullets start shooting through the door. Balestros has to jump off the porch into like some shrubbery. And Balestros just says, "I'm just going to lay here for the rest of the
action." Oh, he's like, "I'm done. I did well. I did my duty. I'm out."
When he looked over, this is not funny. He saw a dead comrade already under a windowsill. He did not think he was going to get out of there alive. The Koreshians, I did not know this, had a bunch of dogs. And these dogs come out to start to attack, too. So they're not only fighting the Koreshians and their bullets, they're fighting the Koreshians' dogs. Now, some of the dogs get shot. They always take fire extinguishers with them for this reason, because they don't want to shoot dogs. And a lot of times the fire extinguisher spray makes them go away, but not all of them. And so, Caroline,
ready.
Some dogs get shot. Now, their initial plan, they had wanted people to go in from all sides. Front, like the north, the south, the east, from everywhere. That's how they were going to penetrate and take hold of the whole compound, right? So they were trying to penetrate all sides in the back. They were getting shot from all around. They even discovered that they had Koreshians on top of the water tower shooting down at the agents. They even had people that targeted that undercover Sierra house down the road where those eight undercover agent men were. That's how they knew that that was an undercover house a long time ago. And they knew who Rodriguez was. All they kept hearing was, "Get off our land. You're going to die. We're going to kill you. What are you doing here? Why don't you just go away?" So it was a war zone. News reporters show up. They set up their cameras off on, you know, on the road. There's machine gun fire. There's AK-47 bullets everywhere. And then you hear an explosion. And at first, our agents, the ATF agents, were relieved. They are thinking, "Oh, our guys finally breached the door," and they used a flashbang. And it's kind of like what you see on movies, right? They breach in, they do a flashbang. You see that flash, and it kind of blinds everybody, and like smoke.
Yeah.
And they're like, yes, they got it. They got in, right?
Yeah. No.
Nope.
No.
The Koreshians pulled out their hand grenades.
Oh.
Remember those?
Yes.
Remember
yes,
those?
Yes, I do.
Now they're like, forget the plan to gain entry. We can't do that anymore. There's no evacuation plan in place at all. The only plan that they have is to stay alive plan. Stay alive. Stay alive. A 911 call comes in. And it has come in from inside the compound. And a Christian named Wayne Martin called. And his 911 call says there are around 75 men at our building shooting at us at Mount Carmel. Tell them there are children in here and women in here and to call it off. He is yelling. He is pissed. Now, when you hear this phone call, he sounds pissed and desperate. Like, why are they attacking us, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And when you hear a lot of this phone call, they're like, we don't understand, why are we getting attacked? Now, this 911 caller, they get a hold of this 911 person on the other line, like the dispatcher, they get a hold of Larry Lynch. He's the lieutenant at the time. This sparks Larry Lynch and David Koresh communication. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, and this is communication that's going to go on throughout the whole conversation. Now, I'm going to play some tape. It's a little choppy. Oh, why is this cord so tight? It's a little choppy. And I'm going to have to fast forward through some of it. However, damn it. It'll give you a kind of insight of David's mindset at the time, what was going on at the time, and where we're kind of going with this.
Hello.
Yes.
This is Dave Koresh. I'm supposed to call you guys.
This is who, sir?
David Koresh. Mount Carmel Center. We're being shot all up out here.
Okay. Where are you?
Oh, where am I? I'm at Mount Carmel Center.
Okay. Hang on just a second.
All right.
So calm. He seems so calm. How do you not know that?
Hey, don't hang up, David, okay?
Right,
I'm gonna get somebody to talk to you.
4427.
Are you in the complex?
70. Hold on, I've got another man.
Are you in the complex?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. We're here.
Okay.
I've got to go down and sell your phone. I'm gonna pass you, so hold on just a minute. Okay, hold on.
It's like a voice phone.
Yeah, this is Lynch.
Hey, Lynch?
Yeah.
That's kind of a funny name there. Oh, listen, no, look.
Now, who am I speaking with?
This is David Koresh.
Okay, David.
The Notorious. What did you guys do that for?
Well, David, what I'm doing is I'm trying to establish some communication links with you.
No, let me tell you something.
Yes, sir.
You see, you brought a bunch of guys out here and you killed some of my children. We told you we wanted to talk. No, how come you guys try to be ATF agents? How come you try to be so big all the time?
Okay, David.
Now, there's a bunch of us dead, there's a bunch of you guys dead. Now that's your fault.
Okay, let's try to resolve this now. Tell me this. Now, you have casualties. How many casualties? Do you want to try to work something out? ATF is pulling back. We're trying to...
Why didn't you do that first?
Okay, all I'm doing is handling communications. I can't give you that answer, David.
Okay.
Okay?
Now, here's the deal. Yeah, you pull your guys out, and I want to talk. But I want to talk. I want to talk what's it called?
I couldn't hear you. I've got Wayne on the other phone, so go ahead now.
Wayne Martin?
Yeah, he's on the other phone with me. I've been talking with him, but
yeah.
You're the man that I need to talk to, David.
Yeah, well, really, let me tell you something.
Okay.
in our great country here, the United States, you know, God's given us a rich history of patronage. No, we're not trying to be bad guys.
Okay.
But the thing of it is this. There is a God who sits on the throne. I know it sounds crazy to you, but you're going to find out sooner or later.
There are seven seals
in his right hand.
Right.
The question of theology has overstepped. Who would have opened that book? Now, that's what I've done.
Okay.
It's your Bible. There are seven seals. Now, there's some things in that Bible that have been held as mysteries.
Yes, sir.
About Christ.
Yes, sir.
Now, when it says in Revelation 22, behold, I come quickly, my reward is with me. The statement is, what reward did Christ receive in heaven from his Father? He received a book with seven seals.
Yes, sir.
Now, when I'm told throughout theological departments that they're going to ruin me because of what I present out of the book, just because they can't present it and I can't, there's a meaning to that.
Okay.
Now, in the prophecies, it says...
Can I interrupt you for a minute?
Sure.
All right. We can talk theology. Right.
No, this is life. This is life and death. The theology is life and death.
Yes, sir. I agree with that.
You have come and stepped on my perimeter.
Okay.
See, we will serve God first. Now, we will serve the God of the truth. Now, we're willing, and we've been willing all this time, to sit down with anybody. You've sent law enforcement out here before.
Yes, sir.
And I've stayed on them straight across the table. I said, if you want to know about me, sit down with me, and I'll open up a book and show you seven things. Just like I told Robert. You know Robert, don't you?
Yes, sir.
You know, the guy that, your agent.
Yes, sir.
See, we've known about this. I've been teaching this for 4 years.
Okay.
We knew you were coming and everything. You see,
yes, we
knew before you even knew.
Well,
there's the spirit of prophecy. The testimony of Jesus Christ is a light that shines in a dark place. Now, you need to learn Deuteronomy 32.
Okay. But let me ask you this. The present situation, let's start resolving it, and then we can sit down and talk. Right now, we've got everybody ceasefiring, okay? So that's what we want. Now, we're pulling the guy back from the door. ATF is going to pull the guy back from the door. All right. Can they come now, David, with your guarantee, and pick up their injured officer without being fired on?
Look, I cannot communicate with everybody here.
Okay. Do you have any way, is there anybody that can? Do you have a facility to communicate with the rest of the folks there in your house?
Well, we would have if y'all guys had talked with us.
Okay. But right now, all right, what ATF is wanting to do is to take their injured troop out of your area. Okay? But what you're telling me is you can't control folks because you have no communications. Is that correct?
Well, if you give us...
So, that conversation ended up being pretty long, but it resulted in ongoing communication, a little bit of trust, and they were able to talk about a possible ceasefire. Mm-hmm. This was my first time when I actually watched the Netflix series that I even heard about a ceasefire happening. So I was like, okay, if we did a ceasefire, why did it last for 51 days? If we ceased fire day one,
yep,
after, you know, an hour or so. So about 10:35 a.m. is when this conversation's kind of happening, and they're talking about ceasefire. And by this time, there have been wounded and killed agents. Our agents are either out of ammunition or almost out, but not them Christians, though. Like, they seem to have an unlimited supply of ammo, like just unlimited. By 11:30 a.m. So this doesn't start prompt the ceasefire immediately. This is 10:35 a.m. It takes another hour for the conversations to go back and forth, and this phone call, like, they hang up and they call back again and they kind of get disconnected, and he goes on and on, and he's saying that I've been talking about this for 4 years. Y'all just found out, but I knew this was prophesied to me. So basically, the Lord gave me this vision 4 years ago, and that's why we were ready, and that's why y'all weren't. He just knew he was doing wrong, is what I was saying earlier. So, Tactical Commander Kavanaugh calls the compound and he speaks with Steve Snyder, which is another one of Koresh's mighty men. And they go back and forth, and Snyder's pissed because he, too, has wounded kids and wounded people, and they both finally agree to a ceasefire. So Snyder's able to get Koresh and the other guys to agree. And by 11:40, the Kavanaugh is able to get the agents to ceasefire, and the agents are able to stand up, put their hands in the air, and walk. They can go and retrieve their wounded comrades, so they have to pick up their dead bodies, or the ones who are wounded, and then walk back that long walk. And okay, and so it's probably like, if it was big as a city block, you know, the whole compound, that's a pretty decent walk to be scared to death, because the guns just didn't get put up. They're still totally being aimed at them this whole time. And you're wounded, you're scared, you're wounded, you're carrying your dead friend. They're walking back to the ambulances. Now, the ambulances are not coming onto the property because you very well could be endangering more lives. And at this time, they have four dead agents and a bunch wounded. And after this is when we will officially have a siege. So everybody gets to leave at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Go back, regroup, people get help. They start contacting families. It's all over the news. It's going crazy. Mm. This is when we are all finding out, like, school stops, right? You're in second grade. Yeah, I think I'm in fifth grade. Stops. And this is when we are all finding out that there has been an active cult right down the street from where we've been living.
Which meant nothing to me.
No.
At the time.
No, it hasn't meant anything to me until now, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, like, I've known about it. Like, yeah.
Big, you know.
And now I'm real pissed about it because I got to do this story. But anyways, it's pretty cool. So that's the end of part four. And that is the end of all of today's episode. And we'll get the end next week. We officially have a siege, which is what they did not want. Here's what kills me. They had a plan to breach, but it never, and this is Dan Morris's quote, but it never crossed their mind to have an extraction or withdrawal plan. It had never been practiced or even considered to have an extraction or withdrawal plan.
But has this happened before, like in any other situation like this?
Nope. In Waco, it's first time.
Not,
so
not
now,
Waco, just in general, like.
Well, this isn't Waco ATF. This is ATF from all over the world. So
right.
Part
so
of
like if they're like, we didn't have an extraction plan. Okay, have you
ever
typically gone and broken up cults and had an extraction plan that you would? There's no plan.
That's right? What I'm saying.
Yeah,
it had never been practiced ever in the history of their books.
Yeah,
or even considered to have a. Oh shit!
Plan for
if something goes wrong.
Infiltrate a cult like environment. There's never been a plan invented for that whatsoever.
I don't even think it needs to be that specific. I think it needs to be: what's the plan if we go and we try to serve a search warrant on individuals who start to whip our ass, which is what David Koresh says in the. And the thing.
They did the search warrant for Warren Jeffs and they did not have this.
Yeah. It shouldn't be have a plan in place for a cult. It should be we need a contingency plan if things go wrong.
Yeah.
What if things go wrong? You need a backup plan that, what if they are ready? Armed and dangerous, what's the plan then? Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's as a commander leader, you want to keep your people safe. You have that backup plan. So he is saying that that has never been practiced. It's never been part of any plans. It's never even been considered. They go in with plan A, and maybe it's just always worked out that they've never needed it until now.
Did you? Yep.
So I bet it's a part of every plan now.
Yeah, probably not.
What if it does not work out this way? Then what? Crazy, crazy, crazy,
wow,
crazy.
Wow-wee.
All right.
How's it going to end?
How's it going to end?
Couldn't tell you. But I
me either. It is. I've not written it yet. Okay. We'll see y'all next week. That is it. And then, can we talk about the live show?
Oh, yeah. What live show?
Save the date for June 24th.
June 24th.
Is that it?
We're doing a live show.
Then we're quitting. Oh, wait. Is it June 24th? June 24th, downtown Waco. We will send out registration information just like last time. Live show.
It's like in a minute.
Slash mixer. Slash Dirty Chad. Be excited. Be excited. We'll give you more details.
Just mark your calendar.
Mark
Just
your
go
calendar.
Ahead and mark your calendar for July 24th. June.
June. Sorry. June. June, June, June.
Did you say July?
I did say July 24th. June 24th. Okay. Yeah. June 24th. June 24th. June 24th.
June 24th.
Start all over. Do we have a live show coming up, Caroline?
I think we do. I think it's in June, and I think it's on the 24th. Is that right?
Mark your calendars.
For when?
June 24th.
The 24th of June?
June. Downtown Waco. If you don't live in Waco, make plans to come and visit. And this will be our birthday. Bloody happy hour. Second birthday. We will be celebrating in June. We will also be celebrating officially Dirty Chad.
We'll maybe give you a little teaser.
Dirty Chad teaser, 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 trailer. Only if you come to the show will you be able to hear that. Not the trailer.
And we may also have a little bit of gear for Dirty Chad. So... you definitely do not want to miss out on this.
Nope, not at all. Exclusive.
When is it? June 24th?
June 24th.
Oh.
Mark your calendars
June
now.
June 24th.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay.
Love it.
This is it. This is it. We will see y'all next week. Don't forget to
stay aware.
Stay alive.
And always be DTF.
Bye, y'all.
Bye.